Well, recently, China's AI momentum has dominated headlines. Zipu AI is expanding into Southeast Asia, the Middle East, while DeepSeek and Minimax continue to roll out models they say rival American counterparts despite ongoing U.S. chip restrictions. OpenAI said in a blog post last week that state-backed Zipu AI has made notable progress in getting several governments across the world to adopt its AI models. And the tech rivalry just saw a new development today. Siemens says the U.S. has lifted export curbs on chip design software for China, restoring access for Chinese clients. That move comes weeks after Washington had ordered electronic design automation firms to halt shipments, sparking backlash from Beijing. Our next guest is one of the most influential voices in global AI policy. Helen Toner is a former OpenAI board member and now director of strategy at Georgetown Center for Security and Emerging Technology, where she helps shape how governments and institutions respond to the rise of powerful AI systems. She joins us now from Washington. Helen, good to have you with us. First off,
great to be here.
OpenAI has been pretty open about, you know, the impact of the likes of Zhiju AI. I'm just wondering how much traction Chinese AI models are making right now.
They're certainly getting plenty of traction, and it's anyone's game. And an important thing to understand as well about how AI development is progressing is that there are really not just one AI competition or one AI race, as people sometimes say, but actually many. So there's a question of who is leading at the very cutting edge of the technology, making the most advanced models. There's different questions about who is leading in terms of adoption, in terms of B2B use cases, B2C use cases in different countries. And we're seeing Chinese companies certainly making a strong showing across many of those fields, even if, you know, I would say that the U.S. is still generally in the lead.
So, but how quickly, though, are Chinese companies eroding China's leadership, or rather U.S. leadership?
It really depends on where you look. So I think if you're looking at adoption across enterprise, and certainly in China, Chinese models have obviously a big advantage. Most of the U.S. companies are not even attempting to go for Chinese adoption. On the flip side, if we're looking at U.S. adoption, corporate adoption, customer adoption, then the U.S. companies have a natural advantage there. Something that OpenAI said about Zhiju in their blog post recently was that Zhiju was really trying to make a play for those third countries. So OpenAI has been on a big spree going across Southeast Asia and other countries, looking to sell their products, looking to set up what they call OpenAI for Countries initiatives, so partnering with specific governments. And what it sounds like is they have heard from those governments as they've been touring the area that Zhiju, this Chinese company, one of the Chinese six little dragons, it gets called, that they're also going and having those conversations with governments, trying to come in and say, look, we can give you a full stack solution. We can give you white glove service to get not just a specific, like a broad-based product, but get something specific to your needs. And so what it sounds like is that Zhiju is a company, in addition to other companies that we know from the Chinese side are trying to do this, like Alibaba, Huawei, that they are starting to show up in these conversations as well.
We know that China and the U.S. approach AI development very differently. When it comes to the Chinese model is open source, they're using cheaper chips. I'm wondering whether that would put a lot of pressure now on the likes of OpenAI to adopt a similar model.
Yeah, there's different pieces to this. So one piece where I think there really is pressure is in this open source question. So this is a lot of the leading U.S. developers, in particular OpenAI and their two biggest competitors, Google and Anthropic, they've really led with what get called closed models, meaning that they're held, they're proprietary, only the company has access to their models, and they can sell access to that via an API or via a product like ChatGPT, without giving the actual AI model away. Whereas other companies, notably DeepSeek, but also other U.S. companies like Meta, are giving away their actual AI model. So this is the open source approach. And for plenty of users, open source is really appealing, both because you have full control of the model itself. You can modify it in any way you choose. You can be confident that you will always have access to that model. The company can't roll it back or change it or change the pricing on you. It's really in your hands. And so it's been really interesting to watch. Google for a while has been offering an open source model that is less capable than its most advanced models. And recently, OpenAI announced that they're actually also going to, for the first time in a long time, make an open source model available that is one of these so-called large language models or multimodal models. They haven't open sourced a model like that in a very long time. And so that shows that they're really feeling the heat and feeling the pressure to provide an offering in that slice of the market. Now, that will not necessarily be competitive with the very best models from the very leading companies. Instead, what you often see with competitive open source models is that they are smaller. They're designed to be easier to use, easier to put on devices, as opposed to some of the very most advanced models that are available, which will often need multiple leading edge chips. You need to have your own server rack to be able to run them at all, which makes them less accessible. Even if they were open sourced, many people wouldn't be able to use them. So we're really seeing some fierce competition in that sector.
Helen, talk to us about, the countries, companies already adopting the Chinese AI models, because we hear, the adoption is pretty much throughout the world, including the Middle East, Asia, and Europe as well.
So what we're seeing, I think, is a lot of experimentation. It's difficult to know how much actual adoption and how much at-scale use that we're seeing. So, for example, in China, in the wake of this big DeepSeek moment in January where that company really broke through and had a huge news cycle, there are a lot of stories about Chinese companies, Chinese local and provincial governments starting to adopt DeepSeek. But it's really not clear if you kind of scratch beneath the surface, what does that look like? Does it look like they ran one trial? Does it look like some of their employees started using the app? Or did it really look like a deep partnership and really serious adoption? It's very difficult to get that in-depth data. One thing we can say is that if you look at, again, these open source models, actually a really big player there is Alibaba. So they have a model series called Qwen, and that is very, very popular. So even on US platforms or international platforms, like Hugging Face is a very popular place to go to find AI models to use. They are showing that Alibaba's models are really very popular, outstripping any of the US models in terms of just sheer amount of use on that particular platform. But it's difficult to make really sweeping statements. Mm. What we can say as well is on the consumer side, OpenAI does continue to dominate. So ChatGPT is up there in the many hundreds of millions of users, which really far outstrips any other competitors.
What are the possible longer-term implications of what we're seeing right now? People often talk about perhaps a decoupling of technology and AI models perhaps in the longer term. What might that mean for the world?
So we've really seen a lot of, technology companies are the place where the US and China are the most decoupled and have been for a long time, right? So Google hasn't been in China for, 15 years at this point. The same is true for many of the US's other leading technology companies. And in some ways, that has been what has made space for China's tech sector to grow and flourish, is that they haven't actually, unlike most other countries in the world, tech companies there haven't had to compete with their US counterparts. But now what we're seeing is with this new wave of AI companies, there was maybe a moment where it looked like there could be more interconnection. And certainly at the basic science level, there's a lot of interconnection between the US and Chinese ecosystem, with researchers collaborating, US and Chinese institutions collaborating, people moving across borders all the time. But what we've seen at the company level and at the product level is actually that continued decoupling. So I think it's a pretty safe bet that that is going to continue to be the case. And then the question is really, what happens again in these third countries? China has a long history of pushing it, what it calls its digital Silk Road, meaning going out there to countries in Southeast Asia, Central Asia, Sub-Saharan Africa, and saying, look, we can work with your governments, we can help you build smart cities, which involves, surveillance systems and, digital infrastructure for governments. That is something they've been doing for a long time at this point, and AI is sort of a natural continuation of that. But it remains to be seen exactly how far that goes and how well they're able to compete with U.S. Mm-hmm. offerings. But it's, certainly a strong showing they're making.
Is it fair to deduce, though, at this stage, that the U.S. will have less influence on how AI can be used or how it should be used, given that China's role in it is increasing?
Yeah, the U.S. certainly doesn't have a monopoly on this. And something that we'll, I think, likely see from China is that if you look at the way that China is regulating and governing these models, a huge concern for the Chinese government, of course, is social control, censorship, the ability to make sure that AI models are not doing anything the Chinese government wouldn't like. And that's not something that the U.S. government is, you know, going to be actively promoting among U.S. companies. It's not something U.S. companies will expect their customers to want. But of course, there are many governments around the world that would love to be able to make use of good tools for ensuring that AI systems don't criticize the government or don't venture into taboo topics. So I think at a minimum, that's an area where we should automatically expect China to be competitive. And certainly if they continue to make their models available, even if they're perhaps slightly less technically sophisticated, but if they're cheaper, if they're easier to use, if they're coming with this push to you know, help you adopt and help customize for your use case, then that will certainly be a place that China can compete.
Cheaper, easier to use, making them more accessible. I'm just wondering whether that raises the question of whether or not China can then use its AI models to spread its own interests, its own information. Is there reason to be concerned about that?
This is a huge question. So you definitely hear this a lot as a potential reason for concern is, do these models embody certain values? Would it be strategically advantageous for the United States to have models that embody U.S. values spread throughout the world? I think it's a little bit of an open question once you dig into it, because in so many ways, often the AI models in question are very customizable, and it's very easy to kind of get rid of, if it's a Chinese model with censorship built in, it's usually pretty easy to get rid of that censorship. Likewise, if it's a U.S. model that has, you know, some U.S. values built in, it may not be that difficult to actually customize it and get rid of that if it's not what you want for your use case. So I think as a starting point, certainly there's a large financial interest, and from there a competitive interest in wanting to make sure that U.S. companies are earning revenue and are you know, setting the standard internationally. I think in terms of these questions around sort of values or you know, whose models are being used, the exact strategic implications are still becoming clear.
Helen, the AI space is developing so rapidly. In 3 to 5 years, how do you see that space shaping up?
So the really interesting thing working in AI is no one knows. And what I mean by that is different experts have incredibly different perspectives on what we're going to see. Some experts think that the paradigm that we are in right now of scaling up large language models, starting to take these chatbots and, you know, add on new capabilities like what gets called reasoning. So this is working step by step through complicated problems, or adding on the ability to build agents. So this is AI systems that aren't just chatbots that chat with you in a window, but are actually able to go out there and take actions in the digital world. Some experts think that that combination of capabilities, so large language models plus more reasoning plus more agency or agentic capabilities, that could get really far and could get to something approaching or exceeding artificial general intelligence, which is a term people use to mean, you know, roughly human level intelligence. Other experts think that is all absolute nonsense, and that the AI systems we're building today are, you know, very far from that and have deep limitations that they're never going to be able to exceed unless we totally change the paradigm that we're working in. So, you know, often my view, I'm sitting here in Washington, D.C. as a policy analyst, and so often I am thinking in terms of how do we make policy or prepare for the possibility that any of these different worlds could come true.